Hey, we're Derek and Jenna. We started our homesteading journey in 2011 with 5 small children, a garden, and a few chicks. Since then, we've added 3 more kids and a whole lot of animals. We're currently renting 37 acres in the Blue Ridge Mountains, where we raise grass-fed beef, grass-fed dairy, pastured poultry and pork, free-range eggs, and a large garden. We also have a couple pet goats, several barn cats, and a beagle. We're working on moving from growing just our own food to selling locally. We homeschool our children and are a full-time family with hopes and goals of farming for a living. We would love to welcome y'all to follow our family on our journey.
Hey y'all.
Hey.
This is a little update, a little short video, just kind of an update real quick.
Well, a lot of you might not even know, I put a post in the community tab on YouTube and then also on Instagram and Facebook. But so if you've seen that, then you know, but there's probably a lot of you that have no idea what we're getting ready to talk about.
Yeah.
So. We had a very scary event this past weekend. It was Sunday. What day was that? The 21st?
21st, yep.
The 20, I think.
It was.
Sunday the 21st of February. We were kind of letting everybody sleep in a little bit and just taking a relaxing morning. The kids are getting up to start doing chores. And the boys share a bedroom. They have 2 bunk beds for the 4 of them. And Jack was sitting on the bottom bunk playing guitar. Jacob climbed down from his bed, woke up and climbed down. Jacob was standing there just like he was shivering. So Jack said, "Are you cold, buddy?" And he said, "Uh-huh." But something was off. So Jack put a jacket on him and was like, "Jacob, are you okay?" Well, in the meantime, Josiah ran to our room and said, "Jacob's standing there like he's shivering." And we were like, "What?" And so we were immediately alarmed. So we jumped up and ran down the hall and, they were saying, "Jacob, Jacob," and he kind of just was blank and he would turn his head, but clearly something wasn't right. So Derek grabbed him up and took him to our room and he sat him on his lap and was like, "Jacob, Jacob, look at me." And he would kind of turn his head towards him, but never track with his eyes. I finally grabbed his face, said, "Can you make eye contact?" And he did lock eyes with me, but again, it was just kind of a blank stare. And then Derek said, "Can you stand up?" And he was trying to stand up, but he couldn't make his legs work. This was all within probably a minute from when he picked him up, brought him to my room. We were doing all this and said, "Derek, I'll call 911. So Derek called 911 and we waited right at the front door. It was very cold that morning. We waited at the front door until they pulled in the driveway and we ran out to the ambulance and he was still very out of it. We were talking to him, trying to keep him aware, but he was very blank and looking like, obviously neurologically something was going on. We were like, "Is this a seizure?" We didn't know what was happening because we've never experienced anything like this.
Yeah.
And we got him in the ambulance and they started to work on him and then he went kind of unconscious.
Yeah,
he wasn't
unconscious,
his vitals were fine, but he was, you know, out, and they said they believed it was a seizure. They started working on him, but it lasted a really long time, like 15 or more minutes. It's how long it lasted. They said usually a seizure will be 2 to 3 minutes, and they did give him anti-seizure medication. So they took off for the hospital. Derek rode the ambulance. I got the kids situated, and of course they were all very worried and scared and upset. And then I followed him and got to the hospital maybe 15 minutes behind them.
Yeah.
By the time
we got to on the interstate, we were probably 5 minutes from the hospital. There was no room for me in the back of the ambulance because they were working with Jacob, but there was a screen so I could watch him in the front, and he started to wake up, like come back to, and he wasn't fighting. He just wanted to sit up, and they were trying to help him down. He wasn't scared because he was still out of it enough to not know really what was going on.
He
didn't know he was in an ambulance with strangers or anything like that. So by the time we got to the hospital and got him unloaded, he looked at me. He knew I was Daddy. He knew he was Jacob. He knew he was 5 years old. He was back being alert and aware.
When I finally walked in, he knew who I was immediately and could answer questions. So they ran blood work and they did a lot of neurological evaluations with the track, you know, track their finger with his eyes, checked his strength and his, and so they ran blood work. And the only thing came back with a slightly elevated carbon monoxide level, but it was not to a toxic point, what they consider toxic.
Yeah.
So they said that could have triggered it, but it was just such a low level, as far as the amount that they weren't sure at first. You know, they said that they needed to do other tests and things. And so they admitted him for the night to do a EEG, a sleep deprived EEG. So, he went to sleep at about well, he was having a hard time going to sleep. They were treating him like a king.
Oh, he was living it up in there.
They loved him. He was, because he was so good. They would put the IV in. They had to do two IVs, because this one, well, they did his hand too. They did two IVs, because this one was the first one, and then it quit working. They did this one. They couldn't get blood out of this, so then they, because they wanted to rerun his blood, because they put him on oxygen to get the carbon monoxide out of his system. So they had to poke his hand, and he was like, he just sat there like a statue, and they're like, you are the best patient. And he said, I want to go home and show my brothers and sisters the holes in my hands and arms. you don't remember riding an ambulance, do you? He doesn't remember. He remembers trying to stand up. He said, I could have stood up. I was trying. He remembered that. And then he remembers being in the hospital, right? But you don't remember the other part? No. And you're being awful quiet now.
Yep.
But within just a couple hours of the whole event, he was right back to his normal
self.
They gave him toys. They gave him Play-Doh. They gave him cereal, because he hadn't eaten all day, and dinner was a couple hours out. It was like right after lunchtime, and we got moved upstairs. So they gave him cereal and popsicles and Pop-Tarts, all kinds of food that he doesn't normally eat at home. We don't eat because they're full of, you know, corn syrup and food coloring. Yeah. But, you know, he was happy.
He was wound up.
Yeah, so he finally, he couldn't go to sleep because it's noisy. The helicopter was landing on the hospital in the middle of the night like four times and all kinds of stuff. But he did go to sleep, and then I had like five times, yeah.
Okay.
So I had to get him up at 4:30 in the morning to keep him awake until they came in for the EEG. So they did that I think they came in at 8
mm-hmm.
in the morning. And
they were finished at 9.
At 9. Yeah. And he did great. He fell asleep while they did it, which is what they wanted. And then we had to wait for results, which we didn't get till like 3 in the afternoon. It was a long wait, because they said, you know, if the results come back normal, then he can go home. We'll just do follow-ups. If something comes back off in it, we would then need to do an MRI and that, you know, get into what's causing it. So we were just like, I mean, we felt a peace. We really felt peaceful about it. We had lots and lots of people praying. And so they came in at 3 and said his EEG was normal. So yeah, praise the Lord. We were
absolutely.
Like, so they sent us home, and he just follows up with a PCP tomorrow, which is Thursday. Today's mm-hmm. Wednesday. And then he goes next week for a follow-up with the neurologist, just to make, you know, they can let us know what to look for in the future. But they basically, we talked with a team of doctors, and the conclusion was, there go the guineas.
Yes.
The choir. The conclusion was the only trigger could have been the carbon monoxide. So whenever they found out he had carbon monoxide, immediately we had the kids leave the house and come to the camper, because we were at the hospital. And then Derek came home once we knew Jacob was settled. He came home. But we've moved into the camper. Yep. This is my parents' camper that they stay in. They live in Florida and they're in town. They stay here in the camper because there's not any room in the house. But within... we didn't realize, like, we all were feeling kind of like brain fog and stuff mm-hmm. a lot, and just a lot of tiredness.
Yeah.
And I had felt a lot of that before, so I was, you know, to me it was kind of normal, but the kids were feeling it. Kylie had been starting to have headaches for the last few weeks every day, which is abnormal. So we kind of started putting two and two together. And everybody has been clear-headed and felt so much better.
This is our third night sleeping in the camper.
And everybody's springing out of bed and wide awake and just feels really good.
World of difference.
And so we don't know. There must be some kind of carbon monoxide leak. And I was reading online about how low levels of chronic exposure leads to all the things, lethargy, chronic fatigue, and then can lead to seizures. And with him being so small, it's going to be... you know, he's going to react quickly, more quickly than anybody else. So we don't know. We're going to have it checked to see where the leak is coming from. I think the gas company or the fire department will do that. We just need to have it checked. We do have propane, but it's not on.
There's no open flame in the house.
No,
so
the furnace
we're baffled
hasn't
completely.
Been working. So we've been using infrared electric space heaters. So the furnace has not been on. So we really, and unless propane is burning, it can't emit carbon monoxide.
Right.
So we really are completely baffled about it. We're going, like I said, we're going to have it checked, but what you having on me? it's been a whirlwind. We came home from the hospital Monday
yes,
evening. Yeah, we got home Monday evening, and then you're going to tickle me. That's silly. Driving Daddy's leg.
Yeah, there you go.
So we have a follow-up appointment, like I said, so we're trying to get everything done, and then we can get them to come out and check for that. But we're going in the house to do minimal things. We have it ventilated over in there. We are not letting, Jacob's not going in at all, or any of the youngest kids, because we just,
be cautious.
We're taking every precaution we can to not have anything. But we feel sure that was it, especially with how we've all felt being out of the environment.
Right.
But we are just so thankful that it was something, even though that's scary and that could have been horrible. Like, I mean, obviously carbon monoxide poisoning is no joke. That could have turned out really bad. We're thankful that the effects on him were just a short period of time, temporary. Thing, yeah. He's 100% fine, acting normal now, and nobody else had anything major happen. But we found out that there was a problem, and we're all okay, so that's good. It's not something that you ever want to go through, the whole event was really
very scary.
Very scary.
Yes.
And we're thankful that there's no seizure disorder or anything like that, no epilepsy. We're exhausted.
Yep.
We're resting as much as we can. We have trying to do other things, chores, and get things done that we need to get done. The weather's turning really nice. We finally get outside and get things done. But I think I was awake for 39 hours, I figured up, aside from in the middle of the night when I was, before I woke him up at 4:30, I think I slept for 15 minutes twice, if that. It was not, how it is to sleep in the hospital. Plus, I was worried about him, so it was just, I'm trying to catch up on sleep. And then I guess because of waking up and being in the hospital, I'll fall asleep, but then I'll wake up in the middle of the night and I'm like wide awake the last two nights. And then I finally get back to sleep. So it's been trying to get my body back into a normal sleeping routine. Yeah. But we are just really praying for God to direct us in what to do next and figure out everything that's going on and what we need to do. So we appreciate everybody's support and prayers, and I guess we'll catch you guys next time. We're gonna do some things. Emma's getting glasses. We're gonna go pick up her new glasses, and that's about it.
Deliver some feed to somebody.
Deliver some feed we picked up, or you picked up.
Yep, work some cows later today when we get back.
And do chores, get things.
Yep.
Get some things in, and we'll catch you guys next time.